My name is Mark Costa. I am the Managing Director of the Conservatory, and it's my pleasure to thank all of you for joining us this evening. If I could, please, everyone, mute yourself while the lecture is going on, so we don't have pets and everybody else adding to the lecture, and so that we can concentrate on this evening's speaker. This evening, we are joined by Dr. Samantha Carouso-Peck, a postdoctoral associate in the Department of Psychology with Cornell University. She has graciously agreed to share this presentation entitled Sing with the Birds. I've had a little preview before our lecture begins here, and I'm very much looking forward to it. I'm glad everyone has joined us. And now, without any further ado, I'd like to turn over this presentation to Dr. Samantha Carouso-Peck. Thank you very much for joining us.
Thank you so much, Mark. Thank you for that introduction. So I'm Sam. I've been studying birds for quite a few years now. I've been at Cornell for about 9 years, and I've studied quite a number of birds, but really my specialty is songbirds and parrots. So they're going to feature heavily in my lecture today. Thank you all for coming. I'm really excited to tell you a whole bunch of very interesting stories about how and why both birds and ourselves learn to sing. And I'm also going to discuss how different their songs and sounds, their songs sound to them from how they sound to us. And a little bit about how they dance and use rhythm. So there's gonna be a ton of audio and video in my lecture, so please make sure your volume is up at a nice comfortable level. And then you've got a nice big image of my presentation in your screen so you can see the video. Let's dive in.
It just went off again. It was on. Could,
I'm asking.
Please mute.
see if you could mean they're starting to talk.
So I would like to start off with a historical music mystery. Now, it's sort of rarely mentioned in his biographies, but Mozart had a particular affinity for birds and actually purchased a pet starling in 1784. And this music right here is something he wrote in his diary, which was a transcription of a tune that the starling was singing when he bought it. And he has this note down here in German that translates roughly to, "That was beautiful." And anyone among you who can read music might recognize that this here bears a striking resemblance to the theme of the finale of Mozart's 17th piano concerto, which he wrote down in his diary shortly after this. So a really persistent mystery in musicology is who inspired who, since the starling was purchased in May of that year, and then Mozart's very first performance of this piano concerto wasn't until June. So who sang it first, essentially? And then some years later, about 10 days after this pet starling died, Mozart wrote his rather peculiar piece called A Musical Joke. That's a really weird piece. It has these strange harmonies and really clumsy orchestration, and it's constantly flitting from one musical theme to another. I found a record jacket that mocked it. It called it an awkward, unproportioned, illogical piecing together of uninspired material. Oh, poor Mozart. But many historians at the time actually believed that Mozart was parodying the poor composing of some of his contemporary composers. But to anybody who studies birdsong, this piece just screams starling. It perfectly mimics their propensity to intertwine tunes and whistle off key. And a lot of that off key whistling Mozart actually reproduced in the horn passages of this. And Mozart was far from the only composer to take inspiration from birdsong. Beethoven's Sixth Symphony includes songs from yellowhammers and quail and cuckoos, and Vivaldi's flute concertos actually were inspired by goldfinch song. So birds have certainly inspired a lot of our music, but we've also inspired a lot of theirs, it turns out. And this is one of the most extraordinary songsters in the world. It's an Australian species called the lyrebird. And lyrebirds are world-class mimics. They can reproduce virtually any sound that they hear in their environment, no matter what it is or where it comes from. And the reason they do this is because female lyrebirds are impressed by males who have huge repertoires of sounds that they can create. So the males are constantly harvesting new sounds from anywhere they can find them. And actually their imitations of other animals are often so spot on that they fool the originals. They lure in other species of birds with their imitations. But they also copy the sounds that we make. So I'm just gonna play a quick clip from David Attenborough's Life of Birds about.
He can imitate the calls of at least 20 different species. He also, in his attempt to outsing his rivals, incorporates other sounds that he hears in the forest. That was a camera shutter. And again. And now a camera with a motor drive. And that's a car alarm. And now, the sounds of foresters and their chainsaws working nearby.
Fantastic. I'll never have enough of that. Although there's a certain tragedy to the fact that he's reproducing the sounds of his own habitat being destroyed. But this isn't a conservation talk. So a little more about lyrebirds is that in 1969, a park ranger noticed that his local lyrebirds were making sounds that very closely resembled flutes, which lyrebirds in other parts of the country weren't making. And it took quite a bit of sleuthing for him to discover that back in the 1930s, which at that point was about 40 years earlier, a man used to play his flute to a lyrebird, and then that single individual lyrebird spread the flute songs throughout the entire population. And not only that, but the tunes that these birds were singing were modified versions of songs that were popular back in the 30s, like the Keel Row and Mosquito's Dance. And wild lyrebirds are actually still singing these songs today. Although apparently they've changed a lot over time, and I'm told that their current rendition of the Keel Row has gotten pretty jazzy and funky and off tune. However, these birds are culturally transmitting human songs through generations and effectively serving as living time capsules of the soundscapes from at this point nearly a century in the past. Although just like human language and song and stories, it has drifted and changed over time. So learning about this really reminded me of humans spreading music across the world and still singing songs that were written, you know, in medieval times, our entire oral tradition. So today I want to talk about the ways that the singing of birds teaches us about our own musicality and how and why we both learn to sing. So birds are phenomenal singers. I obviously think this, I've studied this for a while, but I really don't want to sell short the amazing vocal achievements that humanity has made, which are actually often pretty bird-like, which is high praise from me. So this is a clip from the Queen of the Night aria from Mozart's Magic Flute. So that range and vocal control is actually pretty extraordinary. I'm always very impressed by this piece, how quickly she can get from one note to the next, and how long she can keep making notes. So how exactly does she do this? So mechanically speaking, in our throat, we have our vocal control center, the larynx. And the larynx controls our vocal folds, which are made up of these short ligaments in a V shape. And when we speak, or we sing, these ligaments vibrate just like a string on an instrument and create sound. So imagine if you pluck a rubber band, it's gonna make a nice twanging kind of noise, but if you were to pluck the string on a guitar or a violin, you get so much more richness because it's attached to a box, it's attached to a resonator. And the voice works in a very similar way, passing the sound through our body's resonators, those being the throat, the mouth, and the sinuses. And then we can also further modify the sound by manipulating those resonators. And birds have a few extra tricks that their vocal apparatus can do that ours can't. So here's a quick video of a canary showing off his singing chops. So the reason that canaries can do this is that they can take tiny breaths up to 30 times a second, which allows them to continuously sing for minutes on end. And he's also able to simultaneously sing two notes at the same time, both a rising and a falling note simultaneously. The human larynx obviously can only make one note at a time. And then over here, this is a curassow. And I think the sound they make closer resembles a cartoon character falling off a cliff. You just want a little splat at the end there. But they have tremendous vocal range. And the reason that these birds can do this is their vocal organ, which is called the syrinx. And the syrinx isn't high up in the throat like ours is, but it's actually deep down in the chest, split in the trachea. And what happens is the left side produces low notes and the right side produces high notes. And they can make other notes in between or combined by combining them further up in their throat. And this allows some birds, like curassows and cardinals, northern cardinals like we have around here, to span more pitches than a piano can produce, all in one dramatically sweeping note. So they just start the note with one side and they seamlessly switch to the other side without stopping for breath. And I don't know about you, but I'm pretty envious of this ability, and I bet a number of opera singers are too. The closest approximation of this feat that I'm aware of in humans is throat singing, which is practiced by several cultures. And this here is a Mongolian throat singer who's able to generate two notes at once by manipulating his throat such that one sound is made low down in the vocal cords, in the larynx, and another is generated further up in the throat, like this. So we've actually developed some innovations that allow us to at least emulate some aspects of what the birds can do, but it's kind of required us to work around the limitations of our natural biology, of what our bodies are normally supposed to do. Still, we're very innovative musicians. So we've explored a little bit how we sing, but let's talk about why we sing. I'm sure we all have our own reasons for why we sing, but some common ones. It's certainly common for us to sing in order to express or evoke emotion. At least whenever I watch these reality TV shows with singing competitions, the goal always seems to be, let's make the judges cry. If you made the judges cry, you have probably done very well on your portion of the competition. Then, of course, we sing in order to communicate, to tell stories or express ideas. This is part of a long human oral tradition. Most evolutionary biologists think that we were singing and humming and generally being musical with our voices long before we were producing language. So this was a way to communicate. Of course, we sing for fun. I really enjoy this picture of this man singing in the shower. Singing brings us pleasure, it brings us joy, it releases all kinds of happy hormones like dopamine in our brains. And also very commonly, we sing for one reason or another in order to impress an audience, whether you're a rock band or an opera singer. Often you're singing to someone in order to show off your singing ability. So why do birds sing? It turns out their reasons really aren't all that different. The number one reason for birds to sing is to impress an audience, which tends to be either mates or rivals for territory. Now in North America, in our temperate climate, it's usually male songbirds who sing, but species around the world have far more female singers chiming in to attract mates and defend territory. And this actually leads to duetting, in which the male and the female will sing rapidly back and forth, often in such perfect synchronization, it's hard for a human listener to tell that it's two different singers. And cardinals do this to announce to rivals that the territory is not only claimed, but claimed by a fearsome duo, not just one bird, and also to reinforce that they're both taken and not looking for new mates. But I want to express that globally, unlike in North America, around the world, about 64% of songbird species also have females who sing. It's just not the case here. So that's a big reason birds sing. They also, like us, sing to communicate and to identify themselves. Song carries a lot of messages like, I'm a male, I'm ready to breed, this is my territory, I'm this old, yada yada. Just by singing a single song. And often they lie. Often the ways that birds communicate are lying to each other. So the lyrebirds I mentioned just last week were discovered to lie to female lyrebirds by mimicking alarm calls of other species. In fact, alarm calls of entire flocks of other species of birds in order to scare the female into staying put long enough so that they can mate with her. Which is scummy lyrebird behavior, but very ingenious. Similarly, this blackbird on top is called a drongo. It's an African species, and they will mimic the sounds of meerkats when the meerkats have found something to eat. And the alarm calls scare off the meerkats so that the drongo can steal their food. And perhaps most devious and nasty of all, this adorable bird on the upper left, the northern shrike, has been found to mimic the songs of other songbirds in order to lure them in order to capture and eat them. So birds can be very devious with what they're communicating. But lastly, just like us, birds find singing fun. We have a lot of studies demonstrating this. Birds will prefer to be in a place where they previously sang a song, indicating that they formed an association between the joy of singing in that place and the place itself. And also, singing reduces their stress levels. When you measure the amount of stress hormone in their system after they have sung, it goes down. It's bringing them pleasure. Now, we tend to take for granted the fact that we can learn to speak and to sing, but this ability that lets us do that, vocal learning, is actually an incredibly rare ability that very few creatures have. Basically, it's us and only three different classes of birds: songbirds, parrots, and hummingbirds. No other birds can do this. Chickens can't do this. Birds. And then there's a handful of aquatic mammals: seals, dolphins, and whales. And then the only other two terrestrial creatures, other than us, that can learn vocalizations are elephants and bats. That's it. That's everybody in the animal kingdom who's able to generate novel sounds. Dogs can't do this, cats can't do this. They're born knowing all the vocalizations they're able to make. You can command your dog to speak, but you cannot command him to do anything other than the bark that he makes. He can't alter those sounds. So a big question is how we and they, these animals, learn to sing. How do we get from the vocal skills of young children in music class to those of an opera singer like Pavarotti? It's similar to the question of how we get from being babbling babies to sophisticated users of language. And actually, while I'm on the topic, learning language is kind of a bit peculiar because humans have a very particular sensitive period early in life where it's the easiest. Most of you are probably familiar with this. Anyone actually who's tried to pick up a new language as an adult is aware of how ridiculously hard it is compared to the ease with which we pick up our native language when we're children. That's really when our brains are biologically primed for picking up language. Language learning ability is highest before we're 7 years old, and that just drops off precipitously after that. And if we're not exposed to language during that time, which has actually been the case for a few children who have been isolated from people and from language early in development, it's quite possible to never pick up the ability to speak properly. But according to a study that was published just last year, musical skill doesn't work this way. Someone who picks up a violin when they're 6 or when they're 60 has the exact same apparent capacity to learn to play it. Although, of course, the 6-year-old is going to have a lot more time to get the practice in, which is important. Learning to sing when you're young does help somewhat, with learning good pitch and vocal control. That's a lot of motor practice that you've got to get in at some point, but really nothing else. If you want to try to learn to sing when you're older, you're only limited by the health of your vocal cords. There isn't a sensitive period. However, for birds, sensitive periods for learning to sing vary tremendously between species. So take sparrows. Sparrows will memorize a song first, very early in life. They'll memorize a song from someone else who sings it. And then later, at a separate time, they'll practice that song until it's crystallized. And when a song is crystallized, it's done being learned. The sensitive period is over, and that sparrow can never, ever learn a new song. It's done. If it learned a cruddy song earlier, no going back. Zebrafinches, the second bird here, also crystallize their song pretty early in life, but they memorize song and practice it at the same time. And that's going to be important in just a couple of minutes, so keep that fact in your mind. Zebra finches memorize and practice at the same time. But then some songbirds, like canaries and starlings, are what's called open-ended learners. So they don't have an endpoint to their sensitive period. They can just keep learning new tunes throughout their lives, just like we can. But it turns out learning about music starts even before we're born. This picture right here with the headphones on the tummy, that is not a good way to teach your baby to sing. This has actually been a trend for a few decades now, where pregnant mothers have been playing classical music into their wombs, believing that exposing their unborn infant to Mozart is going to raise their IQ. And this came from a study that was done in 1993 that showed that college-aged adults gain a temporary spatial intelligence boost by listening to Mozart. So jump from the fetuses was a bit of a jump. But this idea has really become one of parenting's most persistent myths. And it simply doesn't seem to be the case that this makes any difference. However, sound and music can travel through the amniotic fluid, through the womb, and fetuses are capable of hearing noises from the outside world at around 26 weeks of development. So unborn babies are learning about and remembering the sounds and the rhythms of their world. We've known for a while now, actually, that babies learn the sound of their mother's voice while they're still in the womb. And then when they're born, they prefer to hear their mother rather than any other person. So there's another study that was done to investigate what exactly babies are picking up on about their mother's voice or about the sounds that they're hearing. So what scientists did was they asked some pregnant women in the 6-week period before their babies were born to read The Cat in the Hat out loud. And you guys know The Cat in the Hat. It has a very distinct rhythmic pattern, like, I know it is wet and the sun is not sunny, but we can have lots of good fun that is funny. Very distinctive. So when these babies were born, they preferred to hear The Cat in the Hat read to them over other books with different rhythm and rhyme structures, even if those other books were being read by someone other than their mother. So it wasn't just the voice they were picking up on, they were picking up on that rhythm, that cadence, the beat, the words that they heard back when they were in the womb. And birds are also learning about sound while they're still in the egg. So these are Australian fairy wrens, and they have a problem with something called brood parasitism, where cuckoo birds, who are absolutely terrible parents, will actually lay their eggs in the fairy wren's nest just before their eggs hatch. And this dupes the wrens into raising their kids for them. It's a very lazy parenting technique, but apparently it works for the cuckoos. The wrens can't tell their own chicks apart from the cuckoos by sight, but they do have this alternative strategy that they've developed. So while the mother wren is incubating her own eggs, she chirps basically a secret password to the developing embryos. So then when they hatch, she makes all the chicks chirp this password back to her before she'll feed anybody. So the cuckoo chick didn't have time to learn the password while it was in the egg, so it doesn't know it, it can't repeat it, and it doesn't get fed. So only the wren's chicks get any food. So we've been studying human vocal learning for decades, and the predominant model of vocal learning throughout that time has really been one of imitation. You say, mama, baby remembers that, oh, mama, okay, stores that in his head, and then tries to get their vocal machinery, their larynx, to say mama. You sing a C sharp, and a child will try to manipulate their mouth and their throat and all their resonators in order to imitate that sound. And the model for bird song learning has been pretty similar. You're a baby bird, you hatch out of the egg, then you find an adult tutor. Usually it's your own father or some other adult male. And then you go off and you practice until what you are singing matches that mental model of what the tutor sounded like, until you have a perfect copy of that tutor's song. And the imitation model works really well for some types of birds, including the sparrows I mentioned earlier. They were actually the very first type of birds in which song learning was ever studied. And what they do is first they memorize a song from a tutor, and they do this by eavesdropping on a neighboring adult that's singing in order to defend its territory. Then later on, in the following season, they finally start to practice and try to match the song that they're producing to their memory of the tutor's song. So this over here is a spectrogram of normal white-crowned sparrow song. If they don't have access to a song tutor during that sensitive period, they develop what's called isolate song, which is this disorganized, abnormal, low-quality song that's never going to get them a girlfriend or never going to get them to secure a territory, and really doesn't bear much resemblance to the normal song of their species. Also, if they aren't exposed to the song of their own species, but they are exposed to the singing of a different species, they can learn the wrong song. So this down here is the song of a sparrow raised by a strawberry finch, whose spectrogram is on top. And this sparrow has done an incredibly impressive job of picking up the song of a completely different species. They're quite capable of doing that. They can stretch their vocal apparatus that far. So memorizing first and practicing later is important for two reasons if you are a sparrow. First off, you want to be memorizing song while your species is singing during your species breeding season, so you don't accidentally pick up the wrong species song. That's very bad for you. Second off, you don't want the territorial tutors who you're copying from to think that you're invading their turf. Because if a young juvenile upstart flies onto your territory and starts singing, that's a clear challenge. You're gonna beat the crud out of him. So this learning strategy that separates the memorizing phase from the practicing phase works really perfectly for these territorial sparrows. But the problem is that for the last couple of decades, we've assumed all songbirds learn using this model. And as it turns out, the imitation model isn't how humans learn to vocalize at all, which is a problem when we're using birds quite a bit, as I am in my lab, to study how humans might learn to speak and to sing. So my lab has found that babies learn to produce sounds by something called socially guided vocal learning, which involves social feedback to babbling, to baby babbling, to guide the baby towards more mature sounds. So imagine a baby will, in the course of babbling, make a sound that happens to sound a little bit more like a word. So it says it sounds like meh. And then the parents are gonna get all excited. Yeah, that's right, good job. You're trying to say mama. And that's going to guide the baby towards more advanced versions of that sound. And whether the animal models that we commonly use to study vocal development in humans, very much like birds, we use them a lot, whether or not they employ a similar learning strategy remains pretty unclear. And that's because interactions between birds are surprisingly hard to study because they're so different from us. They move much faster than we do, and their social cues are very different from ours, and they perceive the world very differently from how we do. So that has a huge impact on how they see and how they hear and how they interact. So this is pretty cool. I want to give you an idea of just how differently birds might be seeing and hearing the world. So I'm going to play an audio clip for you, and everybody see if you can figure out what it is. Or it's loud. Okay, so that horrible noise, which I apologize for, and sort of sounded like hamsters on helium, was in fact a 4 times sped up recording of this. that's Come and Go With Me by the Dull Vikings. So the idea here is, if you speed something up considerably, it becomes unintelligible. We can't make out the words anymore. It loses its meaning. We can't pick out individual notes. Our auditory systems just can't differentiate one sound from the next if it's played too fast for us to perceive. And that difference in auditory speed might be similar to how sped up the way we hear birdsong is compared to how they hear it. So here's the song of a veery, which is a very common songbird. So pretty. But here is that exact same song slowed down by the same amount that I just sped up Come and Go With Me. Isn't that beautiful? I find it absolutely remarkable. And this here is likely much closer to how the birds are hearing this song. Humans and birds hear sound over a similar range, but the hearing of birds is much more accurate, much more acute, allowing them to hear 10 separate notes where a human only hears one. And another example here is a song sparrow at normal speed. And then the same slowed down. It just sounds like a whole other animal. There's so much more subtlety. There's so many more elements in it than we can perceive when the bird is singing at normal speed. So one last one, just to drive the point home. See if you can tell me what animal this is. So if there are any birders among you, that's not going to help you at all because it's not a bird. This is actually a slowed down version of this animal. So essentially, birds and humans and whales are all making some very similar sounds on different temporal scales. It's just sped up or slowed down. So you can see why human ears have a lot of trouble grappling with the complexity and the subtlety of bird song. When to their ears, it's just unfolding completely differently. They're hearing something completely different from us. So in order to understand why these social influences on vocal learning have been totally overlooked, it's useful to know that birds can perceive time much more slowly than us. And can actually detect motion, which is twice as fast as humans are capable of detecting. So my very favorite example of this comes from manakins, this family of birds, which are best known for these crazy elaborate courtship displays. They ricochet, they moonwalk, they do these coordinated acrobatics and so on. All of them, that is, except for this guy, the black manakin. And here's his courtship display. That's all he does. He hops up and down. That's it. A lot of bird books describe this display as dull and dumpy, which I think is a bit unfair, but compared to all the cool things the other manakins do, that's a pretty bad display, rhythmic hopping. Or so we thought, until of course we put a camera on them and then slowed down the action. So here's what they're actually doing. I'm going to play that again. But what you're seeing here is that every one of those dull, dumpy hops is actually a perfectly executed 360-degree backwards somersault executed in about a third of a second. And we can't perceive it at all, but the females of this species perceive it very carefully and are extremely discriminating. They want it to take exactly a third of a second or they're not going to mate with that male. So it's understandable we've overlooked this sort of behavior in an elusive jungle bird, but we've also started finding these bird time behaviors in our pet birds, like this cordon bleu finch. So here's his little courtship display. He hops, he sings. So let's slow that down again. He's tap dancing. He's alternating his feet, something we can't perceive at all with our human eyes at real speed. And this female's really scrutinizing him. And doesn't he sound like a whale? Oh, the female didn't like that last little dance. That was not well coordinated enough. I don't know about that. But the point is that when you're studying a small animal with a much faster metabolism than us, it's really important to consider not just what we can see them doing and what we can hear them doing, but what they can perceive each other doing. Otherwise, these kinds of behaviors go undiscovered. So this all leads to my very favorite story about bird song and where a lot of my doctoral work came from. So according to that imitation learning model, birds are learning by copying a tutor, right? But you remember that cuckoo who laid their eggs in the fairy wren nest? You have to wonder what happens to them. They're raised by a totally different species with no one to teach them their song and no tutor to copy from. So this here is a brown-headed cowbird, which much like the cuckoo lays its eggs in the nests of other species. And then the young birds are raised by a totally different kind of bird, never meet their own parents, probably never interact with one of those adult male tutors, but still somehow they're developing species-typical songs. So some crazy scientists, actually my advisor's advisor, decided to raise some baby cowbirds in one of two conditions. Either they raised them in an aviary full of singing adult males that they could copy from. This just ideal learning conditions. Here are all these models you can copy from. Or they raised them without any exposure to song at all in an aviary full of females who, at least in this species, do not sing. And what they found was that these birds were raised with the females who never in their entire lives heard a cowbird sing, learned far more potent, effective, sexy, amazing song than the ones who were raised with these amazing adult song models. And this made absolutely no sense. This just flew in the face of every model of bird song prior to that point. How do you learn without imitating? So this is where we get back to the zebra finch. Remember, I asked you to remember the zebra finch? This is a species which, like us, hears and remembers sounds and tries to learn to produce them at the same time during development. So that means, unlike those territorial sparrows, they are not just working off their mental model of memorized song. They can actually update what they're trying to learn based on any feedback they get about what they're producing. So this is the species I primarily study, and actually the most studied songbird in the world. And like cowbirds, the males completely change the song that they learn if they're raised around females, which again is in direct conflict with the whole imitation model idea. And in fact, scientists just sat in front of cages full of zebra finches, watching them for hours and hours, and just could not see any possible way that these non-singing females could be influencing the song of the young males. So, thinking about the mannequin, and I thought, are there cues that these birds are giving each other that we can't see? And then we discovered this tiny motion that mother finches are making in response to the immature babbling song of their sons. It's called a wing stroke. And here it goes. If anyone blinked, I'll play it again. This is slowed down, but it's still very rapid. These motions they make take a fraction of a second. And it's just this little tiny wing movement that is basically the bird saying, oh, that sounded good. Oh, that was arousing. How interesting. You're on the right track. So I'm going to quickly describe an experiment that I did where I just raised male baby zebra finches together and I let them listen to the song of their father. That was their tutor. until the point in their development where they started practicing song themselves. At that point, I separated the brothers and put them in two different conditions. And the two conditions were a feedback condition and a yoked control. And what that means is the brother in the feedback condition, every time he produced a song across the course of development, I would be sitting there waiting to press a button. He sings, I press a button, and that plays a video of a female doing one of these wing strokes. Good job. This would simultaneously trigger the exact same video to the yoked control bird in his own separate aviary, such that both of the birds received the exact same feedback at the exact same time, but the feedback conditioned brother was getting it based on his own song production. I sing, I get feedback. And the yoked control brother was receiving it based on a schedule yoked to the feedback conditioned brother. So from the point of view of the yoked brother, this was totally random. This female was just appearing at random times, unrelated to what he was doing. And in every other way, these two birds are raised identically. So let's see how their song turned out, shall we? So this first spectrogram here is from their adult tutor, their father. So this is what zebrafinch song normally sounds like. It's a really cute song. I love how squeaky they are. I'll play it again. This is normal zebi song. So that's their tutor. Here is the song of the first juvenile who got that feedback every time he sang. So it's not exactly a match to the adult tutor, but it's quite good. It's a pretty good match. And compare that to the brother who was on that yoked schedule, who's getting feedback seemingly at random. Just completely falls apart. It's really very sad. It doesn't even sound like a zebrafinch anymore. So without that feedback, without that consistent, understandable feedback, it completely pushed his song in the wrong direction. Every so often he'd sing and he'd happen to get feedback. It would drive him in a different learning direction. So he just got very confused with this random feedback. But this is really flying in the face of the idea that learning to sing is all about imitating a model. There's lots of social feedback, which is feeding into that and pushing these birds in totally different directions. And actually, we humans also learn to sing really well from feedback. So for example, we of course learn really well by trying to sing a pitch and having it corrected or demonstrated by a teacher and then trying again. So that's a kind of social feedback. But we learn especially well from being able to see how far we are from the correct pitch. And some studies have shown that people trying to learn to sing with correct pitch learn best from being given a visual indicator of where their pitch is compared to where it's supposed to be. So from that idea actually came the visual pitch training system from the video game Rock Band. I don't know if any of you are familiar with this. So the person who's singing is trying to get the arrow to match up to the right pitch point. And he's not very good at it, but nonetheless, believe it or not, this is incredibly helpful for figuring out how to adjust your pitch if you have this visual feedback to learn from. And it's interesting that visual feedback is so useful for learning to something auditory, something oral. So now, I've talked a lot about pitch, but I've totally neglected rhythm, which is also very important for singing and musicality. And also, I just feel like you can't have a talk about bird vocal learning without mentioning parrots, because they're the kings. So rhythm, the ability to keep a beat, is actually a huge deal in the animal kingdom. There's very few animals other than ourselves who have any sense of rhythm at all or able to follow a beat. In fact, even our very closest relatives, like great apes, chimpanzees, completely lack this ability. They cannot keep a beat. So this is Snowball, the Eleonora cockatoo, and he's gonna jam to Another One Bites the Dust. And what's amazing is Snowball does this beat synchronization completely spontaneously. He wasn't trained to do this at all. And this requires an animal to be able both to recognize the regularity in a sound sequence and to detect and follow that pattern in the sound sequence, and then be able to adjust their own movements to correspond to that beat. It's really hard to do. It's a lot of steps. And this is actually a naturally occurring behavior displayed in the wild, for example, in this palm cockatoo. And palm cockatoos advertise their territories and attract mates, not by singing, but by drumming. They make tools out of sticks, they carve into drumsticks, and then they drum them against hollow logs. So essentially they're using the log as a sound amplifier external to their own body, like an instrument. And each male cockatoo also has his own signature beat that's distinctive from other males. So they're advertising exactly who they are. They have an identifier rhythm that they're broadcasting. And parrots just really like to play with sound. And all the time, they're making use of external amplifiers like we use instruments. We actually estimate that some species of parrots have the intelligence of three-year-old children, and that's certainly evidenced in their exploration and play behavior and how they play with sound and music. So this is Harley, who's an umbrella cockatoo. So as you can see, she's spontaneously discovered that she can alter the sounds that she makes by using a cup as an external resonator, kind of like a child yelling into a toilet paper tube. And here's an Amazon parrot using a tool for keeping a beat along with his tune. Pretty good. So what I find so interesting is that so far we've only found evidence of rhythmicity like this in species that are also vocal learners. And by the way, if you want more evidence of this, please Google sea lions dancing to Boogie Wonderland. It's great. But this fact strongly suggests that there's some kind of connection between being able to learn to produce novel sounds with your larynx or your syrinx, and being able to perceive the patterns and sounds and adjust your motor activity accordingly. That seems to go hand in hand. Being able to adjust your motor activity, whether it's your whole body or just your vocal cords, in order to produce new sounds or follow them. So that's where singing bleeds into language. Named Alex. Living in birds probably originally evolved for those functions of attracting mates and claiming territory. These parrots have co-opted vocal learning in order to refer to things in the world, like we do. Alex knew over 100 different referent words, and he could identify things by the labels for objects, like by saying truck or block, and by words for color, shape, size, number, and what things are made of. So if he was presented with an array of blocks, like on the bottom right here, you could ask them a complex question like, what color number bigger? Which means, what color is there more of? And he could answer, blue. And he knew both written numerals and he could count. So if you clicked your fingers four times, he could say four. But most interesting to me was that he also spontaneously created words for objects that he didn't know the labels for yet. So for example, the first time he saw an apple, he didn't know the word for it. But he did know the words for banana and cherry. So he labeled the apple banary. Similarly, the very first time he saw an almond with its shell still on, he called it a cork nut. So he would create his own words. He'd play with language and sound and recombine things into new meanings. So it seems that for birds like us, they originally evolved this ability for vocal learning, not for speech, but for song. Our ancestors likely sang and whistled and hummed before they spoke language, with words developing from notes and grammar and syntax developing from rhythm. And it's really the same way with these parrots. They co-opted the ability of birds to sing into this amazing ability to speak. So language seems to have emerged from music. So in interest of time, I'm going to sum this all up, but essentially there's just so much we still can learn about how we sing and imitate and keep a beat and hit a good pitch and speak from the way that birds do it. Just like lyrebirds, we are passing our song, our oral tradition down through generations for centuries. Like the canaries, we can keep learning to sing throughout our lives. We don't have a sensitive period for that. We can keep learning new tunes. Like the fairy wrens, we're learning about sounds early in life. Even before we're born, we're already learning about rhythm and music and cadence. Like the zebra finches, we're learning from vocal tutors, but also we don't necessarily need them in order to learn. It's not all about imitation. We're also learning from feedback, especially visual feedback, surprisingly. And lastly, like the parrots, we're able to naturally entrain to rhythm and keep a beat, and we have learned how to use our sounds, use our vocal learning to communicate meaning. So that's all I've got, and I'd be very happy to take any questions in the few minutes we have left. Thank you all so much for listening.
Thank you, Sam. We did have one question come in through the chat, if you don't mind.
Absolutely.
What about mice? We had a question about whether or not mice engage in this sort of singing behavior as well. Is that a myth or is that a real thing?
No, that's absolutely a true thing. Fairly recently, while I was in grad school, it was discovered that there are these species of singing mice who sing for very much the same reasons that birds sing. They sing in order to attract mates and to defend territory. The difference is they're not learning. They are not vocal learners. The males of the species are born knowing how to sing. They grow up and they sing the same song regardless of how they developed, whether they had any exposure to other mice. It's innate, much like a dog bark is innate, a chicken cluck is innate.
That's very
good question.
Absolutely. Well, I for one can't wait to look up the sea lions. You've really primed the pump there. I think there'll be a flood of YouTube views there.
Good. Yeah, and look up more Snowball videos. He's great.
Absolutely. So if anyone has any other further questions, feel free to engage the chat feature. Okay, great. Marianne writes, how do cowbird chicks learn their songs if the mother is absent?
Yes. Oh, very good question. Yes. So what happens with young cowbirds is their sensitive period is delayed. So for their first several months of life, they aren't memorizing song. They aren't learning from their host parents. But then when they leave the nest of their host, they go off into the world and just start interacting randomly with other birds. They interact with basically any kind of bird that they can find that's sort of a dark color. And through some miracle, they tend to end up near females. They can't interact with the males because, as I mentioned, the males are very cranky and will beat them up. But they can get up close and personal with these random unrelated females. And those females who are not their mothers, are not their sisters, are giving them this feedback. Just not on purpose, they're not trying to teach them. They come up, they sing at them, and the females react. They either say, oh, that was good, that was arousing, I might mate with that someday, or they don't. And that shapes their song.
Fascinating. Excellent. Are there any other questions for our presenter this evening? I know that we're getting a little late in the evening, but I really appreciate it.
There are more on chat.
Hi, Peggy. Peggy, did you have a question?
I did have a question. First place, thank you for this fabulous presentation.
Thank you, Peggy.
And will this recording of this be available someplace?
Yes, absolutely. We'll have this available on our YouTube page, and we will make that available through our website as well, through the Conservatory
website. Thank you.
Absolutely. Thanks for joining us, Peggy.
Oh, my pleasure. There are lots of other questions on chat.
Yes, I was just going to get to those.
Okay. Thank you
so much, Peggy. Janelle writes, have our relationships with birds developed through time or deepened, I guess in reference to vocalization or song?
Yeah, huh. I would argue that we've really had a relationship with birds and bird song since we could perceive it. Obviously, the birds have been singing for a lot longer than we've been talking about bird song. But there are references to birdsong in ancient hieroglyphs, in all kinds of very ancient writings. There have been birdsong influences in our oldest known songs and musical compositions. I think we've really, our civilizations have developed alongside birds, and they've always been a huge part of our cultures. Whether that's deepened, I certainly think we've gotten a much richer understanding of birds and their perceptual world over time, as we've done more science and we've put more resources into understanding them. So in that sense, maybe so. I also worry sometimes that we're not as close to birds as we used to be, since we don't spend as much time in nature. So make sure you spend lots of time in nature.
Well, spring is definitely on its way, and I think this lecture could not have been better timed, as we start to hear more birds. Absolutely. David asks, what does Sam have in her office, which I believe is a reference to the bird on your mantle.
Oh, that guy. So he's a sandpiper, not a singing species of bird. It's a shorebird who's not a vocal learner. But I really like them. They're the ones where if you go on the beaches around the coasts, they're running incredibly rapidly through the surf, which I think is marvelous. Was that what you're talking about, David?
I didn't see a response. Moving on, Graham Hall asks, does it confuse birds when we imitate them? I've wondered that too.
That's a great question. Thank you for asking. So especially now there are all these apps on your phone that can play bird song. A lot of people have used that to their advantage for luring birds in. They can play the song and then the birds will approach. Please don't do that. Please don't do that. The birds will be convinced that there's now a bigger, badder, territorial bird in their space, who no matter where he looks, he can't find, where is this bird? And no matter what he does, no matter how many displays or angry countersinging he does, he can't get him to go away. So as far as he's concerned, he's going, oh no, there's an intruder on my turf. He's much meaner than I am. I'd better get out of here. I'd better go look for food or a mate somewhere else. So this isn't the case for every species of bird, but as a general rule, you know, you can whistle a little tune to a bird, but don't persist. Let him think he's won if you're going to duet with a bird, because it can be disruptive.
That is a great piece of advice.
Just, yeah, back down.
Well, we'll all try to keep that in mind. Good. Yeah, thank you so much for this lecture this evening. This was really fantastic. Last call for questions for anyone.
Oh, my absolute pleasure. Evening.
Okay, so it looks like we've come to the end of the hour. Thank you again so much. We really appreciate it. And of course, if you'd like to share any more of your recent work or any other related work, I'd be more than happy to share that on our website as well when we post this video for others to enjoy.
Great. Thank you all so much for listening.
Thank you so much. And of course, we have many other events and workshops coming up in the very near future for the Conservatory. We have a wonderful Celtic event coming up that will be on Friday, March 26th. We have a fiddle player named Vi Wickham who's going to be performing live stream. And we also have a beginner's drawing class, which is going to be beginning on the 14th of this month with the inimitable William Benson. So make sure to enjoy that. All of the information about our upcoming events is, of course, available at our website, tcfa.live. Dr. Samantha Carouso-Peck, thank you so much again. I hope everyone has a wonderful evening. Thank you so much.
Good night.
Good night.